Meet Nina, binti Kamil. Kamil is her foster father's name. The question is it allowed in Islam? How does Islam views this issue?
So, first question is, do you know if adoption in Islam differs from other cultures or religions? Do you know how it differs?
No. I think it's just similar. Some certain situations are similar.
Alright.
Haida, how does child adoption differ from other cultures or religions?
Well, in India, however, adoption is far from the norm. And the children there in orphanage tend to stay there. Well, I think maybe because if you think that in India there are some regions, some areas in India where the people there are so poor. So originally to think the people there can barely afford themselves, their own family. So how can they possibly afford to adopt a child? The major reason there is Hinduism. So in Hinduism, there is no stipulation at all either way about adoption, since it is not a heavily doctrinal religion unlike Islamic view. While in Pakistan, adoption is not common among the Pakistanis, because according to them, it is due to the issue of inheritance too. While in Western countries, how it differs from Islam is the adopted child there carries their adoptive parents' name, not their biological father's name. That is the problem there, as if the child is their real child. And also, they are never told about their biological parents and their real identity, which is really opposite with Islam. So this will cause some problems, including if the adopted child is not aware of his or her real identity, so there will be a chance of the child to marry a marriageable kin, his or her own mahram, of his or her biological family line, without being aware of that.
Okay. The second question, can adopted child use his or her foster father's name? If not, why?
If not?
Why?
To me, it's like, yes, you can.
You can.
Pada pendapat saya, rasanya tak boleh sebab kita kena tengok waktu dulu Rasulullah ambil efek sebagai anak angkat dia pun Rasulullah tak pinkan Zaid pun dengan nama dia. Sebab Rasulullah kata macam binnya binti ni untuk hak kepada ayah kandung anak tu.
Rauda, can Nina use her foster father's name in the certificate?
No, he cannot use that. Allah says in Surah Al-Ahzab,
ادعوهم لآبائهم هو أقسط عند الله فإن لم تعلموا آباءهم فإخوانكم في الدين ومواليكم وليس عليكم جناح فيما أخطأتم به ولكن ما تعمدت قلوبكم.
In this ayah, Allah has ordered the foster father to retain the adoptive biological father's name in every situation.
In fact, asbab nuzul for this ayah was due to the story of Prophet adopted son, who was known as Zaid ibn Muhammad. Later, after the revelation, Rasulullah has referred back his name to Zaid ibn Haritha, which is biological father's name.
Alright, so third question. How this case impacts someone's lineage in terms of first wasiat lah?
Macam tu, it depends on the family lah. Sebab wasiat dia hak untuk keluarga lah, hak kita keluarga. So, kalau dia nak tak.
Rezeki wasiat, rasanya si bapa atau mak angkat pada anak tu perlu mengutamakan anak kandung mereka. Tapi kalau lainlah cerita dia kalau anak tu anak sesat lah.
So, like in the case of Nina binti Kamil, Kamil is the foster father's name, right? But in the sense of wasiat, it's the matter of Mr. Kamil himself. If he wants to be trustworthy, if he wants to be genuine, then he should know that for adoptive child, they can only, adoptive child cannot inherit the wealth because there is no blood relation. But what Mr. Kamil can do is to make a will in favor of Nina, but only to the extent of 1/3 of the estate, not more. But only 1/3 of the estate.
So, how does adopting child impact the lineage in terms of one?
In terms of lineage, it will only affect the adopted daughter, because for the daughter to be married in the future, she needs a wali, and the wali cannot be the parents who adopted her. The wali need to be the judge, not her parents, because the parents is not her biological one. So therefore, the parent cannot. Yeah, but then for the son, the adopted son, it is okay because they are not required.
Kalau ni, even someone tu anak angkat, rasanya dia perlu menjadikan wali haji.
Based on the words of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, there is no marriage except with the guardian and two witnesses. Hadis narrated by Al-Baihaqi. So the guardian here can be her own biological father, her own biological grandfather, her brothers, her uncles, her own sons, or anyone who has any man who has blood relationship with her. And also from the word of Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, whoever who is a woman whose marriage is without her own guardians, her marriage is cancelled. So her marriage is cancelled. Hadith narrated by Imam Ahmad.
And next question: can a single parent, an unmarried parent, adopt a child?
I don't know the validity of this one, but then I know some who's not married yet, but then he or she adopts a child. For example, one of our artist singer, Elvis Naini, he's not married yet, but then he still adopts a child.
That also depends on his macam mana kata kemampuan dia. Kalau dia mampu, kalau dia rasa dia boleh jaga budak tu sampai dia lebih become more human. Kalau lebih stupid. So, he can.
Can any person adopt a child? To answer this question, actually, generally in Islam doesn't forbid for anyone to adopt a child. And then, with the right intention and the right way, safeguarding a foster child can be a good deed that can bring rewards to that person, continuous rewards to the barzakh and the hereafter. Mm. And also, there is actually a real case to this situation too. I read it somewhere about this person. She is in her late 40s. She's going to be 50 soon. And then, she's single too. She's not married yet. And then she was thinking one day that I think I may not be married because I have no chance to get married because I'm in my late 40s right now. So, but I want to have a child. So I think about adopting a child. And because if I want to make that child to be my real child, of course I need to breastfeed that child. So to do that, I need to breastfeed the child, isn't it?
Yes.
But I am not married, and I'm also not having any child too. So is it permissible in Islam? Because I can actually meet a doctor and take some hormone treatment where I can, from that hormone, I can produce milk. So I can breastfeed that child. Mm. So from this situation, the person. The Ustaz answers to this woman's question, where the Ustaz says it is permissible actually, because in Islam, in order to breastfeed, it doesn't require you, the woman, to be married or to be in a certain age. So it is permissible in Islam, even though you are
Here is Nina with her adoptive sister, the biological daughter of Mr. Kamil. When it comes to inheritance, how is it distributed?
So, in the case of Nina, because she has a sister, which is a biological sister to her adoptive parents, it's still the same thing, because Nina is still an adoptive child. So she doesn't have any blood relation to the family, right? So what the family cannot give inheritance to Nina, because she doesn't have any biological blood related to the family. But what the family can do is to give out a will in her favor, which is less than 1/3 of the estate. It doesn't matter if Nina has a sister or not, it still stands.
How Islam solve this problem?
Right, so Islam is very easy, right? Mm-hmm. So for the case of adoption, if adoptive parents still want to make sure that the adoptive child becomes much more easier for the adoptive child to live, what the foster mother can do is to breastfeed the child. So that the child can become a mahram. And when the child becomes a mahram, the issue of aura, like in the case of Nina, she's a girl, so there won't be any aura boundaries with the foster father. So in the case of mahram, how a child will become a mahram is to breastfeed more than 5 times, and also to breastfeed the child within the first 2 years of the child's life. Basically, when the child is less than 2 years, you breastfeed them, and then they can become a mahram. And when it comes to mahram, like I said, the aura, the issue of aura will be much more easier to live in the same house, right?